Hi there, my name's Claire Balding and I'm a television and radio broadcaster, mainly in sport for the BBC and for other channels as well. It's really interesting looking at LGBT rights and indeed attitudes to LGBT people through the lens of sport, and I'm particularly going to focus on women's sport because since the early 20th century with the record goal scorer and iconic footballer Lily Parr to the 21st century with the boxer Nicola Adams and global superstar Megan Rapinoe, I think women's sport has been a place where it is important to be able to be yourself. Billie Jean King and Martina Navratilova have both been vocal advocates for equal rights and for the LGBT community to be respected and valued. And visibility is a really important thing. For as long as people stay hidden from view or deny who they are and who they love, then there will be a stigma of shame, and that shame passes on from generation to generation. On the flip side of that coin, if you can be happily visible, if you can be proud, if you can be comfortable and confident, if you can be generous with your experience and with your time, then I think you pass on an aura of positivity to other generations. And that is how the world changes. And it has changed. It's come a long way since Martina Navratilova was at the height of her powers, as she told Sue Barker.
You talk about your family coming over. Did you buy them a separate house because you wanted to protect them from finding out?
Well, no. I needed the space on my own. Even if I had been married with a man, I still would have wanted that separate house. You know, I'm an adult now and, you know, the parents live next door. They literally live like three houses down. So
I'm not sure there's ever been a bolder, more visible, more successful lesbian icon than Martina Navratilova in the 80s and the 90s. And tennis in many ways has led the way in terms of equal pay and attitudes to the LGBT community. Billie Jean King always says it was one of her greatest regrets that she didn't earlier come to the realisation that she needed to be her authentic self and she needed to talk about it. But my word, the campaigning she has done since has really made up for that. And it has paved the way for the likes of Amélie Mauresmo, Jana Novotná, Conchita Martinez and Sam Stosur, all Grand Slam winners who happen to be gay. They haven't necessarily been active campaigners as such, but not everybody wants to be and not everybody has to be. Alison van Ooytvanck of Belgium is one of a new generation of players that really wants to be able to talk about her relationship. And she's been with her partner, Griet Minnen, for 5 years. They got engaged at Christmas. They play doubles together and they also sometimes play on opposing sides of the court. They did that in a tournament in Germany recently. And after the match was over, as couples do, they kissed. This is what Alison had to say about it.
It was actually not a bad match. We were like, okay, we will just go fully, both of us, and we'll see what happens. And I think we were happy it was done, but before and after was fine. I mean, we had a good match, and whoever won after the match, it was done. And we were back girlfriends, so.
Yeah, it wasn't easy for sure. I mean, you just have to put aside that she was my girlfriend and that, you know, when you win a point, normally you're happy and, you know, you show it. But during this match, we kind of just kept neutral all the match because we just, of course, we both wanted to win. But still, I mean, you don't want to rub it in the other one's face. Like, I just won this point. So, we were just happy it was finished and it will happen again, probably.
Now, interestingly, there are quite a lot of instances of couples playing for the same team at the moment in women's sport, whether it's Pernilla Harder, a world record signing for Chelsea, and her partner Magda Eriksson, who's the club captain, or Nat Siver and Catherine Brunt on the England cricket team, or Meg Jones and Celia Kwanzaa for the England Sevens team, who recently spoke publicly about their relationship for the first time. Perhaps most famously of all, Kate and Helen Richardson-Walsh, both part of the gold medal-winning team for hockey at the Rio Olympics.
Holly Webb on her way to win gold for Great Britain. Scores! That's the golden goal! Great Britain have won the Olympic gold medal! The hockey history makers! Great Britain are the Olympic champions and they are top of the world.
Can I ask you first, when did you first play together?
That would have been back in 1997.
Yeah,
for the England under 18 team.
And what was the environment like in that team? Can you remember whether people were willingly embracing of diversity, let's say?
I wouldn't have said so particularly. I don't think it was intentionally discriminatory. I just don't think it was a topic of conversation. I think it was a very much presumed that you would have a boyfriend. I think that's kind of where it went, which is discriminatory, let's be honest, but I don't think it was necessarily conscious.
And obviously it took a long time before you were actually involved in a relationship. When that happened, how quickly did you feel you needed to tell the rest of the team?
It wasn't something that we felt we wanted to do or felt comfortable enough to do straight away, if we're honest.
We told a couple of people in the team who were also in leadership positions. I think because we were building up to an Olympic Games, I think it was just felt that the thing actually, let's just not rock the boat, let's just keep this as is.
Your teammates, as I've talked to a lot of them, say you were, as a couple, so inspirational to them, and that actually they were really proud of you.
Actually, now that has happened for one couple, you're now starting to see it happen a bit more openly for lots of other couples in other sports. So it's kind of opened that door, which is great. It's made it way more comfortable. And I think the key thing was, right at the start, as soon as it was something that was now open, was that we spoke about it. It was put on the table as this is happening, this is the case.
And the reaction, luckily, for nearly everyone, is never as bad as you think it's going to be. But I do feel that within sport, where you're talking about such marginal differences, that the fear of being outed or the fear of being open can limit some people in their performance.
100%.
Yeah, without doubt. If you can't be your whole self, and you're carrying a weight around with you. You know, you've got the pressure of day-to-day life, you've got the pressure of performing every day, and then this added weight, I think it would absolutely affect you.
It's just those simple like daily questions, yeah, or the conversations that happen around you all the time. Like when we first got into the team, or you meet new people and they say, oh, you know, have you got a boyfriend? And you're just like, straight away, that question. Or the fact that you're dreading that question coming just like is there constantly.
Once you were open and got a much better reaction than either of you had probably anticipated, what difference do you think it made to you on the pitch? Did you feel better as players?
So I was already out for a few years before then, had a relationship with Kate. And actually, you know, having conversations with people who knew me reasonably well, just saw a completely different person. They now saw somebody who was, I don't think it's confidence. I think it's beyond confidence. It's just like a way. And they're now actually seeing the real me rather than somebody that's trying to hide themselves.
I think the general assumption is, women's sport, it's all right. Mm-hmm. But men's sport needs work. Is that false?
I would imagine that there's still a perception of, oh yeah, oh, another couple,
yeah,
that kind of thing. And I think that's where education comes in. The more we're able to speak about these things to youngsters, and actually they see the person behind the sexuality or the gender or the sports person, the more then they're able to just think, oh, they're just people, and it's fine.
I remember 20 years ago giving a talk at whatever UK sport was then. So all of the coaches are in the room, and I was talking about women's sport and how we could build it. And I said, and I would like to talk about the elephant in the room as well, that women's sport has a very high percentage of gay women. And I deliberately, I didn't use the word lesbian because I have the same mental thing going on in my head that whenever it's been said to me, it's been a negative term. So I said gay women. And I think we need to discuss that. I think we should really, you know, be transparent and open and talk about how women's sport's a very accepting place for diversity and for same-sex couples. I mean, the horror and the silence. And I was stunned because I thought, God, you're really scared of this. And I think it's because a lot of people in senior coaching positions and senior management were scared. I think they were scared. And I think they were worried that parents would, you know, it's like, oh God, don't talk about it. Because parents already think if we let our daughter play women's sports, she's going to become a lesbian. And I think the old fashioned assumption was, you go into women's sport, you're going to be a lesbian. And it was never said in a positive way. It was never, you're going to be a lesbian. It was always a negative thing.
And that's why, I mean, we still struggle to know how to identify ourselves. Because I think in part because of how the term lesbian has used in such a negative way, particularly in a sporting context. Yeah, she's another, you know, Kate's gone to the, she's a lesbian now because, you know, and it's just, it's then that's another, you know, we need to reclaim that word and see it again as for what it is, a positive part of the community, the LGBTQ plus community.
I'm sort of hopeful that the young ones now, the ones who are sort of 10, 11, 12, 13, just starting their sporting experience, their sporting life, I just don't think they grow up with the same negative connotations. I don't think they care.
You know, when I go into schools, I definitely agree with you. I've had my rainbow laces on or, you know, rainbow on my hockey stick. They ask me about that and they want to talk to me about that. And I'm always blown away because I'm like, wow, I never would have asked a question like that when I was your age at school. And then I think, but then the people that they're surrounded by, you know, what are their views and opinions and what impact does that have? But the, now the power of social media is another layer of people they can follow, get in touch with, talk to, listen to, share with. And I think that's something we didn't have growing up, for sure.
Or just female sport being on TV.
We
remembered kind of watching the Olympics every 4 years or Wimbledon every year. And that was the only time we really actually saw women playing sport. Mm. And so it's not where it needs to be by any stretch, particularly now with COVID, it's actually gone backwards. Mm. But the more that women's sport is on TV, that just makes such a big difference because you do get to see a diverse range of people and what they look like. But yeah, so there are a huge amount of different role models, and I think that is really positive and that is playing a massive part in this changing, for sure.
I so identify with what Helen says about a weight being lifted off your shoulders when you're able to be honest with everyone around you. You're happier, you're more relaxed, you're not lying anymore. You are stronger, and so are your teammates or your workmates. I think, though, the fears are real and the challenges still exist, and you worry about being excluded or disapproved of or shamed, or in some senses, and this goes back to what Martina Navratilova was talking about, you worry about not being promoted, not being supported in your career. Well, luckily, there are so many examples now of companies who are forward thinking and outward looking and who actively want to support individuals who are just that individual. Many of the best paid sportswomen in the world are also gay. Look at Abby Wambach, the USA's leading all-time goal scorer who won 2 Olympic gold medals and a World Cup. Now she's a best-selling author and motivational speaker. Megan Rapinoe, winner of the Golden Boot and the Golden Ball at the FIFA Women's World Cup, renowned for standing with her arms outstretched, challenging authority at every turn. And quieter in her manner is Australian goal-scoring dynamo Sam Kerr, one of the best paid players in the world, having signed for Chelsea last year. All of them have shown that there is no commercial price to be paid for being out and being proud. And look at the examples on TV as well. Kelly Smith, who I think is one of the best football pundits around. Casey Stoney, the former England captain and now the manager of Manchester United's thriving WSL team. Both of them have children. And that has shown as well the younger generation that you are not curtailed from having a family. You are not denied that delight because you're in a same-sex relationship. That in itself is an important example. So what does the future hold? Well, rugby union is one of the relatively young sports, certainly at club level, as an option for women. And let's hear from one of the exciting players. She's a winger for the Sale Sharks. She's also a science teacher at a secondary school, and her name is Caris Hall.
So when I was younger, I dabbled in a lot of different sports. My mum used to take us to karate on Saturdays while she went to the gym. I did cross country with my older sister. And that sort of then translated into doing indoor athletics and going out to do track and field, competing at the city championships and stuff like that. And I really took hold of athletics for a long period of my life. I also played football when I was younger as well. But then I switched over in uni to rugby. Rugby sevens first and then went into rugby 15s.
How would you sum up the atmosphere in women's rugby compared to other sports in terms of its allowance of you to be yourself?
It's the typical, you can be anybody type to play in any position, to play the positions that we need. But it's also, I find, people don't actually question your sexuality when you go in. And even if it is a question, it really doesn't make any difference because you're all putting your body on the line at the end of the day. I know I've always grown up being quite muscular and very much not wanting to wear a dress. And I was thinking whether that sort of played into myself not wanting to come out and come to terms with being queer sooner, because I didn't want to play into those stereotypes of being the girl that has the short hair and plays football and does all the really stereotyped masculine sports. And I know that just on that reflection, I was thinking that's probably why I didn't go to play rugby earlier, because I did play tag rugby when I was in primary school and that sort of just fell to the sideline. Whereas when I went into athletics, it was sort of just like, okay, I can just hide away for a little bit and just do what I need to do and be the person that's with the muscular body, but it helps to sprint. And I know I was speaking to my friend the other day and she used to get people asking if I was gay. And I didn't really know back then, but I was, and having her say that to me, I remember questioning myself whether I would appear gay. And I mean, as an adult now, I don't think there's anything wrong with that. I should have been proud of that when I was younger, but again, having people put labels on you that you weren't ready to understand or even understood yourself was, I guess, quite difficult and can be quite difficult. But I guess as we get more people speaking about being in the LGBT community, showing that it's a multitude of people, people can start being more comfortable and it doesn't have to be sort of a negative connotation on your identity.
Yeah, and I wonder if, you know, you're in a really interesting position because you're also a teacher in secondary school, you're a science teacher, you're seeing kids, and you can therefore, I was trying to think of a clever sciencey term that wasn't just litmus test, but you can, you know, you've got a take on their changing attitudes.
Yes.
Do you think that kids these days are more open-minded, more fluid maybe, more... Just kind of relaxed in their attitude to sexuality?
I have one story from teaching, when we was teaching in school, and the kids were having this discussion and I really enjoyed listening to them because they're so intelligent and they're so well-read as well. So there was a conversation between, I think, a young boy and a young girl just talking about the use of homophobic slurs. And I always quote her because it just really took me... I think I was inspired and I wanted to be like her when I was young. So I was looking at this girl talking to this boy saying, you know, you can't be using those words just so flippantly and then not realising that you are in a position of power. And she literally said to him, you are a white, cisgendered, straight male and you don't understand how it is from the perspective of someone who may be questioning their sexuality or just being simply a female. And there was another kid that really doesn't really engage in my class. And I sort of let this conversation evolve. And the girl at the front sort of turned around. And again, she's a person of colour. She was just like, and you really don't understand, like, just by looking different from everyone else, that there may be struggles. And I saw there was two boys in this conversation. And one of them just went into himself and you could see him reflecting on actually what he was saying, because these girls were his friends that have always been his friends from year seven onwards. And you could see the other boy that was sort of like working through his thoughts by speaking to them, but it really made the conversation far more powerful. And I, as I said, I was blown away by it. And I really wish that there was someone around me that was so strong in who they were. I wish that was me when I was younger.
How important do you think it is also to see women in very glamorous positions, like Nicola Adams on Strictly Come Dancing, choosing to dance with another woman?
I think it's fun to talk about Nicola Adams, and they chose to come up to me and talk about it because she's gay. And it was quite nice, actually, for them to have that conversation with me and it be just a conversation about someone doing really well on TV.
Caris Hall there, talking at the end about the importance of seeing Nicola Adams on Strictly Come Dancing, dancing with a female part, quiet and shy. Some are funny, some are serious. Some can dance, some can sing, some can do neither. Not everyone is going to have the desire or the ability to go on marches and make public statements. Not everyone will go to be tolerated and accepted, but to be embraced, to be cherished, to be celebrated and championed. And women's sport is showing how. But there is always more that can be done so that the next generation can reach their full potential, can be proud of their teammates, and can be proud of themselves.